Good morning. Welcome to worship here at Incarnation Lutheran Church. My name is Joel Vanderwall, one of the pastors here. It's good to have you here inside where it's nice and cool and the air conditioning. For those of you worshiping at home, thanks for being here. It's good to have you here as our church without walls. As you can see, this past week was a wonderful week of Vacation Bible School. Thank you for your prayers and for your support of that ministry. As hundreds of kids took over the church, took over outside, it was a great week to learn about Christ and Christ's monumental love for each and every person. Later on in the service, Pastor Janet Carvin in Montgomery will be continuing on in our sermon series about questions that God asks us. And also today we have a guest organist, Christina Wehrling, is here. Thank you for being here. Thank you for leading us in worship. Just to get another insight as to what Vacation Bible School was like, I'm going to invite Caitlin Davis to come up and share a little bit about her experience. She's one of our summer interns that we have this summer.
Good morning, everybody. As Joel said, my name is Caitlin, and I'm one of the interns this summer, and I had the wonderful opportunity to work alongside my three other interns and staff to lead VBS this past week. The theme was called Monumental, and it was based off of Monumental Valley, which is located in the desert. One of my favorite parts was watching the kids sing and dance to the theme song, Our God is an Awesome God. It was a community effort to make this event possible. There are around 80 volunteers and 120 kids. It was inspiring to see everyone collaborate to make it a fun and positive week for the kids and the volunteers. It truly has been an honor to be able to partake in this internship this summer and work alongside amazing staff and see the inner workings to make something as big as VBS happen. I am blessed to be able to grow in my faith and become that much more involved at Incarnation this summer. Please stand as we read together Psalm 139. O Lord, you have searched me and known me. You search out my path and my lying down. Where can I go from your spirit? Or where can I flee from your presence? If I take the wings of the morning and settle at the farthest limits of the sea, let us sing together.
Thank you.
with you. Let us pray together. Creative Spirit of God, you have blessed us with gifts to be used in loving service. Give us the grace of encouragement to find ways to share our gifts with the neighbor and stranger alike, so that all people have an opportunity to experience your grace and love. Amen. You may be seated.
Just what they want to see. You will see the things that never die. You will know and recognize by simple childlike faith the priceless truth that others will deny. When others say I'm just a man who like to dream his dreams, when others call a miracle a myth, you listen for eternity as they pass, and see with spirit eyes what others miss. Upon this rock I'll build my kingdom, upon this rock forever and ever it shall stand, and all the powers of hell itself shall never more prevail against it, for Satan's thrones are built on sinking sand. Upon this rock stand the storms of time upon this rock. If in a simple carpenter you see the Son of God, if you will choose to lose when you could win, if you will give your life away for nothing in return, then you are where my kingdom will begin. Upon this rock it, for Satan's thrones are built on sinking sand. Upon this rock I'll build my kingdom, and on this rock forever and ever
Thank you. Good morning, everyone. So good to be with you on this perfect Minnesota day. No complaining about weather, all right? Let's just get the ground rules set. We continue on in our sermon series based on the Trevor Hudson book, Questions God Asks Us. And today's question is, what is that in your hand? Will you pray with me? God, grant me the serenity. Grant us the serenity to accept the things we cannot change, the courage to change the things we can, and the wisdom to know the difference. Amen. If I say the name Moses, what do you think of? What image comes to mind? Do you think of Moses Malone, perhaps, the old ABA basketball player, chairman of the boards? What was in his hand? A ball. Moses Malone was one of the first ones to go from the high school ranks and leapfrog college and go right to the NBA back in 1974. It was the first time it had happened, unheard of. And now, if you stay in college and play 4 years of college basketball, your chances of making it to the NBA are not very good because everybody goes to the NBA a lot earlier now. Maybe you don't think about Moses Malone like I do. Maybe you think about Moses Howard. You know, Mo Howard from the Three Stooges, the comedic slapstick vaudeville act that was very big from the 1920s through the 60s. His real name was Moses. You know, not a lot of people name their kids Moses. But since we're in church and since it's Sunday, you're probably thinking about Moses, the biblical character Moses. You know, Charlton Heston, I mean. From the Cecil B. DeMille's epic movie, The Ten Commandments. It's on every year around the Easter season. I'm sure many of you have watched it. I watched it with my parents, and I've made my kids sit and watch it as well. But you know what? 3 hours and 40 minutes, I'd really recommend that you stream it instead of sitting through all those commercials. But Moses, the Moses, his story is epic in all senses of the word. The two large events that we associate with Moses, first, of course, in the book of Exodus, is the Exodus, the Hebrew people being released out of slavery from Egypt and moving on into the promised land, and Moses being the one who would be the leader of this movement, this human rights movement, in which God already gave him a slogan, and the slogan was, "Let my people go. Tell Pharaoh that I said the message is, let my people go." And Moses was also the big recipient of the Ten Commandments. Those, he went up on Mount Sinai, was given those two tablets of the covenant relationship guideline rules that God gives us because God wants to be in relationship with us and wants us to love God and to love our neighbors. And so Moses was the one that brought those tablets down because it's all about our relationships in our life. You may remember that Moses came on the scene as a little tiny baby, and he was actually growing up in a time as a Hebrew where the Egyptian Pharaoh was committing genocide, killing all of the little baby boys, allowing the girls to live, but telling everyone to kill the boys when they were born. Somehow Moses snuck through the cracks and was saved by his sister Miriam, put into a little basket down by the Nile River, and was found by the Egyptian princess who actually ended up taking him in and adopting him into their family. And so he grew up in that household, and while he was there as a Hebrew living in an Egyptian household, he saw how terribly the Egyptians treated the Hebrews, and he saw one Egyptian beating up on a Hebrew person. And it angered him so much that he went out and he killed the Egyptian. And then he got scared. And he thought, I better get out of here. So he fled. And he went into hiding for over 40 years. He fled to a place called Midian, where he was a shepherd for a long, long time. But what Moses would learn is that he could run, but he couldn't hide. Not from God. Today's text in the story comes from Exodus starting in the book of the third chapter. Our text actually will be in Exodus 4 if you want to get ready to look at that. But just to kind of set it up, the text from today is set in the burning bush story, that amazing story where God sees Moses tending sheep, and he starts a conversation with him. It's really a call story where God reaches out to him and knows him by name. And he tells Moses that he has heard the cries of his people. He's heard their suffering. He's heard them begging for help, suffering as slaves in Egypt. And so God says to Moses, I'm sending you to lead your people out of Egypt. And Moses right away is like, whoa, 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 whoa. Who am I? Who am I to go to the king and tell him to let go of all those people? And so God tells him that he will first want to go to the people of Israel and tell them what the plan is. And that's kind of where we pick it up in Exodus 4, verse 1. Because God told Moses that the leaders of Israel would listen and that he would be there to give him the power he needed. Moses answered, but suppose the people of Israel do not believe me or listen to me, but say, the Lord did not appear to you. And the Lord said to him, Moses, what is that in your hand? He said, a staff. And he said, throw it on the ground. So he threw the staff on the ground, and it became a snake. And Moses drew back from it. The Lord said to Moses, reach out your hand and seize it by the tail. So he reached out his hand, and he grasped it, and it became a staff again in his hand. So that they may believe that the Lord, the God of their ancestors, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob, has appeared to you. Again, the Lord said to him, put your hand inside your cloak. Moses put his hand inside his cloak, and when he took it out, his hand was white as snow with leprosy. And God said, put your hand back into your cloak. So he put his hand back in, and when he took it out again, his hand looked like the rest of his body. If they do not believe you or heed the first sign, they will not believe the second sign, or they may believe the second sign. If they will not believe even these two signs or heed you, take some water from the Nile, pour it on the dry ground, and the water you shall take from the Nile will become blood on the dry ground. But Moses said to the Lord, oh, my Lord, I have never been eloquent, neither in the past or even now you have spoken to your servant, but I am slow of speech and slow of tongue. And the Lord said to him, who gives speech to mortals? Who makes them mute or deaf, seeing or blind? Is it not I, the Lord? Now go, and I will be with your mouth and teach you what to speak. But Moses said, oh, my Lord, please send someone else. Gospel of the Lord. How's that for a call story? Moses didn't exactly say, I will, and I ask God to help me, did he? Rather, he started giving excuses. They won't believe me. I don't speak very well. Well, author and South African pastor Trevor Hudson, who's written the book that we're based our series on, writes that Moses gave five excuses. And he said these are excuses that are throughout the story of Moses. And Moses is found all pretty much through the Pentateuch, the Torah, the first five books of the Bible. But these five excuses come up now and again throughout these chapters because he wanted to sidestep God's call. Five excuses that I think maybe we use sometimes if we feel that maybe we're not enough, or a call comes into our life and we're just not sure about it. I'm nobody. I don't know enough about God. What happens if I fail? I don't have what it takes. Somebody else could do better. We think we don't have the resources. We don't have the skills or the knowledge. You know, we're really busy. We don't have a lot of time, and I'm tired. You know, I really don't have the energy or the money or the influence, etc. And we just justify our own lack of action. It's pretty easy to do. And sometimes we stop ourselves in our tracks. Maybe you can think about a time in your life where you've had some doubts or fears that have kind of stalled your life, or stalled a dream, or stalled an idea. Maybe we get overwhelmed. Changing circumstances in our life and the world can place a lot of burdens on us. It's easy to just not even know where to start. Or maybe we believe that we must accomplish everything on our own, by our own efforts and power, and that we really forget that the creator of the universe created us and has given us all that we need. What is in your hand? Are we just hardened? Are we lazy? Are we apathetic? The question for the day is, what is that in your hand? God asks Moses this question, and it was really to help Moses to know that he had all he needed to carry out his mission. The staff in his hand was really going to be used to perform signs as Moses would go through what he would be going through, to demonstrate that Moses had God's power, God's miraculous power. Remember the Red Sea that parted so they could walk through it? Moses had all that he needed with that staff. What more could he need than God with him? You know, it's nearly 30 years ago now, and I haven't really shared this story in church, but I met my husband Al and his son Dave, and it was back in the early 90s, a couple of years after they lost their beloved mother and wife to cancer in her 30s. And I was really excited about our relationship, and as things developed, I started thinking, uh-oh, if this works out, I could be the mother of a 10-year-old boy. You know, it wasn't just the two of us, it was the three of us, you know. But how could I ever be as good of a mother to David as, well, his mother? And Debbie was a wonderful person. She was an elementary school teacher. She had her master's in children's literature. And I grew up in a household that had a lot more basketballs than books. And I thought, how am I going to be the one to help him with school or teacher conferences or all those kinds of things? And I was 31 years old. I had my own business and my own house. And I thought, you know, I could go through life being very happy by myself, having a single life. And I really was kind of planning on that. How was I going to be the cook now and make decent food for this kid? All he wanted was cheese on everything. I'd have to put my sister on the speakerphone so she could, like, talk me through or walk me through how to make an egg bake. And sometimes I'd even make a candlelight dinner for them. And David would walk in and a beautiful table set with candles, and he'd say, "Hey, I can't see my food. Turn on the lights in here." But, you know, my dogs, a couple of boxers, Chester and Emmy, were like my kids. Took really good care of them. And they helped me in making a connection with this 10-year-old boy. And one time I just remember feeling a little bit lost, and I went to Debbie's dad, Jack, and said, "Jack, you know, I don't know, Debbie's shoes are pretty hard to fill." And he told me just what I needed to hear, what I was hoping he'd say, is that you don't have to fill her shoes. You have to just be yourself and do things your way, and it'll be good. And the day I knew it was good, I was in the kitchen, and all of a sudden I heard, "Mom, Mom, come up here." And I thought, that's me. So I ran upstairs, and that was kind of the beginning of knowing that I was the mom for this boy. And so I never would have imagined, back in those early 90s, I never would have imagined that little Dave, with his Twins baseball cap on, would be my basketball camp partner for half of the 30 years I ran my basketball camps, and a girls basketball coach at Mounds View High School. I would have never imagined that I would get to be the grandma to his children, he and Sonia's beautiful children. And we've really forged a very close family. And he's really the glue for our family with our other three kids. But we walk by faith and not by sight. And we don't know the big picture or what's around the corner. And I'll just tell you that the big picture is filling in over these last 30 years to be filled with opportunities and blessings and ways to love and serve. You know, sometimes when you're in this unfamiliar place, you have a new relationship or a new job or you move to a new place, sometimes you feel kind of out of sorts because the ground just seems a little bit shaky. Maybe it's a new season in life, and you can't even really imagine what's around the corner. And the temptation, if things get a little bit difficult, or if you're a little bit unsure, is just to opt out. What do you hold in your hand? God asks. Whatever it is, God wants to use it, and what is in our hand, he wants to use it to change the world for the better, whether it's big or small, whether it's something that you even want, necessarily. Because sometimes we look at what's in our neighbor's hand. God didn't ask us, what's in your neighbor's hand? God didn't ask us, don't you rather have what's in your neighbor's hand? So we need to let that go. Let it go. And accept what God has given us. Like Moses, we all have things that we can share for the common good. We can share as the volunteers did for Vacation Bible School and show up for those days for those kids with our time. We can share by showing up to pack food for the Feed My Starving Children. Or we can send money to Ukraine and think about others. We can bring items for the Solid Ground families who are families in transition experiencing homelessness. And if we have a few extra dollars around, we can use that money to send to various efforts that are reputable. We can even help pay for some of the things in this building, like some new windows and a better parking lot with handicap access for people. Trevor Hudson says that God has uniquely gifted us with abilities. He's uniquely gifted us for a specific purpose, and that you already possess these abilities to bless others. Isn't that good news? And the second part is our experiences. From the moment we were born, he says, through all of the things that happen in our life, good, bad, and otherwise, God has been forming us to be a difference-making member of the human family. That's our life experiences. And so it's our abilities, it's our experiences, and you know what else it is? It's even our inadequacies. The things that we don't have can help us see that God will carry us through when our excuses are threatening to shut us down. Our inadequacies do not have to stop us, but can actually help us to lean in more, to depend on God. That's what Moses had to do, where he was lacking. God used him in a variety of ways without him even knowing what the larger story was. God just said, Moses, let's go. His story is epic. He had so many gifts and talents. He was a shepherd, a lawgiver, a prophet, a prayer, a military leader. He even appointed judges and resolved legal disputes. Moses had many gifts to share, but he was not a perfect person. He had the support of his brother and sister. Aaron and Miriam were alongside of him. They supported him sometimes, and other times they challenged him. But he remained a person of faith, chosen by God for a specific purpose. You know, the Apostle Paul writes about the body of Christ on earth and how we have various parts, and all that all the parts are needed to be able to bring God's kingdom to earth and also for the common good. And so we all have what we need to move forward, being grateful for what is in our hands and being ready to be astounded by what God will do to bring healing to the world through what is in our hands. May our lives, our abilities, our life experiences, even our inadequacies, be a return of thanks to God for all God has done for us in Christ. I'd like to end today with a poem that Trevor Hudson, the author of the Question God's Ask Us book, has written with regard to the Moses story. I'd like you to read it with me responsively. The Lord said to me, go. And I said, and God said, yes, you. But I answered, and the Lord said, you're stalling. The Lord said, go. And I answered, but what happens if I fail? I don't have what it takes. What will others say? And the Lord said, stop wriggling. The Lord said, go. But I'm on my own. Who will help me? It's too scary. And the Lord said, do you think I'll be far away? And the Lord said, go. And I shrugged and said, okay, Lord, have it your way. Here I am. Send me. Amen. Please stand as you are able as we sing together.
Lord of sea.
Together we profess our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us join our hearts and minds together in prayer. Holy and life-giving Spirit, we give you thanks this day for all of the abilities and resources that you give us to further your kingdom here on earth. We thank you for our talents, passions, and convictions that lead us to living out a vision of a world filled with your grace and love. Holy Spirit, we give you thanks for this week of Vacation Bible School, for all the relationships that were formed, for the tireless energy of our volunteers and staff, and most of all, for the ways in which your Spirit moved in this place and in the hearts of the children who came to discover about your monumental love that you have for them. Lord Jesus Christ, we lift up to you today all those in our world who are suffering. We especially think of the people of Afghanistan who are recovering from that devastating earthquake that happened this week. For the over 1,000 people who lost their lives in that earthquake, for the countless others who lost their homes and businesses as they continue to mourn the loss and grieve those who have died. We pray for your protection upon them. We pray for the people of Ukraine who continue to be embattled by war with Russia and ask for you to bring about peace in that area. And as we think of those suffering around the world, we also lift up to you those in our own faith community who are suffering now. Those who are recovering from surgery, those who are about to go into surgery, those who suffer from mental illness or struggle with financial needs of unemployment or underemployment, and even those who are grieving the death of a loved one. As we lift them up to you in the quietness of our hearts, we beg for your healing touch. Lord Jesus, where peace is needed, grant your peace. Where healing is needed, grant your healing. Where physical resources are needed, embolden us to give generously. Heavenly Father, you called your servant Moses to go and free your people from Egypt, to give them a new identity, no longer called slaves, but your people. And you invited them to love and to serve you. You gave your leader Moses all that he needed to accomplish this. He had those miraculous signs that he gave just in the palm of his hand. Most of all, that came from you, and so we give you thanks for the way in which you embolden your people to release others from slavery and from the things of this world that seem to enslave us. This week, as we begin our annual Tons of Love food drive for Ralph Reeder and get excited to feed the hungry in heart, body, mind, and spirit across the globe through Feed My Starving Children, we pray for that same courage to act. Remind your people that you have blessed us with more than enough so that we may share in that abundance with others. We pray for all those who will be impacted by these life-saving gifts of food and household resources. May it be a reminder of your love for all people, and help us to simply go as you invite us to go into this world to feed the hungry in heart, body, mind, and spirit. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let us prepare ourselves to receive the gift of Holy Communion. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right and our duty and our joy that we should, at all times and in all places, give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so, with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Our Lord Jesus was betrayed, he took bread, and after giving thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. As often as you eat of it, do so remembering me." In the same manner, after they had eaten supper, Jesus took the cup, and he blessed it, saying, "This cup is the covenant in my blood, shed for all people for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you drink of it, do so remembering me." The bread which we break and the cup which we bless are the communion of the body and blood of Jesus Christ, who teaches us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated. Christ is the host of this meal, and so we invite all to come to partake and to participate in this life-giving meal. As you come forward, an usher will release you from your rows, and you can receive the gift of the host or the wafer. If you have need of a gluten-free wafer, just indicate that to your server, and they'd be happy to give you one. Then we invite you to dip it into the cup. The cup is divided into two halves. The dark-colored liquid is wine. The light-colored liquid is grape juice. If at this time you'd prefer to have one of prepackaged communion sets, by all means, you may have one of those. They're just at the beginning of the communion line. Also, if you happen to have brought an offering with you, there are offering plates at the end of the aisles. All is now ready. Come and eat. I'd like to invite the communion service to come forward at this time. Now may the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in God's grace. Amen. Just a couple of next steps for us before we sing our closing hymn. And the first is to let you know that next Sunday, July 3rd, there's just going to be one worship service at 10 a.m. Weather permitting, it'll be outside, just outside door 6 here. So bring a lawn chair, bring some blankets. Should be a great service. Pastor Kai told me this morning, right now it's predicted to be 86 degrees that day. Beautiful day for it. So please join us next Sunday at 10 a.m. If inclement weather comes, then we'll just move inside here in the sanctuary, and so we'll still have worship. Remember, 10 a.m., just one service. Also want to let you know that our Tons of Love campaign starts today, and so this is to benefit Ralph Reeder, our local food shelf, and there are some specific items that they're looking for this week. Those are in regard to summer essentials that people will need. And this is crucial because many of you know this, but during the summer is a time when food shelves get hit the hardest because their school isn't in session. And so there's more need for kids that may not have enough food at home. And it's also a double-edged sword because it's also a time when a lot of people are on vacation and they're not giving to the food shelf. So this is a great opportunity for us to love our community and to continue to give in that way. So if you're able to bring in some of those items, there's a bin in the back. Anytime the church is open, feel free to bring those. At the same time, we're also going to be gearing up for our Food for All, which will be happening at the end of July, July 29 and 30, connected with a Feed My Starving Children mini mobile pack that we're going to be having. So please join us for that. Signups have already started. It's going to be a great way for us to not just feed our local community, but to extend that food for all people into the world. I'm going to invite Gil Hartley to come up at this time. He's one of our council members. Just to share some updates about one of the capital campaigns that is going on right now in regards to the water intrusion project and our parking lot project.
I am a Lutheran. I don't sit in the front pew. I don't talk about money. I don't discuss my salary. When Pastor Kai asked me to talk about why I personally made a financial commitment to these capital projects, I didn't know where to start. I was both eager and intimidated. Struck me, though, that if I reframed it as a question in which God asked me what my motivations were for donating to the projects, it would simplify things. God already knows my motivations, so I would need neither to conceal nor to dress them up to appear more acceptable. My motivations are selfish. They grow out of enlightened self-interest. We are social animals. We seek community. We're imperfect animals. We seek God's guidance. We are troubled animals. We seek God's consolation. How do we find community, guidance, and consolation? One of the most important ways for me is to come to church, to be with you all face to face, and to be with God. To do this, I need a place to come to, a place where I can be overwhelmed by the consoling effect of music, and where I can find guidance in the prayers of the liturgy and the message of the sermon. In order to be such a place, the church building needs to keep me warm or cool and dry, and to keep the equipment of worship warm or cool and dry. I'd be mighty distracted if rain were dripping on me, or worse, on the altar, the pews, the organ, the piano, the hymnals, the tables the children sit at in Sunday school. The church grounds need to be safe. Skating across a frozen parking lot in winter from car to church door puts everyone at risk, especially, but not exclusively, those of us who go unsteady on our feet. Everything we build is subject to deterioration with time and needs to be repaired. In order for us to go on finding community, guidance, and consolation at Incarnation, we need to repair the facilities previous generations have left to us. I have faith that we, the Incarnation community, will rise to the challenge. Please give thoughtfully, prayerfully, and as generously as you can.
Following the service, Rick Gravely, our facilities manager, will be in the back to answer any questions that you may have about these projects. I invite you now to please stand in body or in spirit and join me in singing our closing hymn, This Little Light of Mine, hymn number 677. Thank you again, Christina, for leading us in worship as our guest organist. It's been good to have you here. Will you please join me in thanking her for leading us? So appreciate it. God said, go. And so go with this sending. God is with you no matter what. Go now in God's presence and love. Thanks be to God. We'll see you next Sunday at 10 a.m. outside.